Future Talk Radio, you're in to all things music.
Welcome to Making It with Terry Woman, the show that explores the secrets, successes, and strategies for making it in the music biz. And now, here's your host, Terry Woman.
Welcome to the show, and thank you for tuning in. I want to say a quick thank you to my guest on last week's episode, Kalimba Records international recording artist Greg Manning. If you didn't get to hear it, you can listen to all of our episodes at entertalkradio.com/makingit or download our app and take us with you. Also, be sure to tune in next week to hear my conversation with Grammy and Emmy Award-winning composer Charlie Fox. I'd like to take a moment to also thank the companies that help me sound my best, whether I'm performing live or in the studio, recording and producing music. Blue Microphones, Taylor Guitars, Duesenberg Guitars, Seymour Duncan Pickups, Mesa Boogie Amps, D'Addario Strings and Planet Waves, Motu Digital Performer, IK Multimedia, Fishman Acoustic Amps, and Exotic Effects. So often I get asked questions about the creative process, so I created this show to focus on what it takes to have a lasting career in the ever-changing landscape of the music business. You're really in for a treat, as I've invited my friends, some of the best and brightest in music, to share their stories on how they have influenced the music that has shaped our lives. I guarantee you're going to love it. So let's get started. My guest today is one of my favorite musicians, Dave Koz. 9-time Grammy nominee and saxophonist extraordinaire Dave Koz has established himself as a platinum-selling artist, humanitarian, entrepreneur, radio host, and instrumental music advocate. He has been honored with a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame and has charted 9 number one albums on Billboard's current contemporary jazz album chart, including 2015's Collaborations 25th Anniversary Collection on Concord Records, a retrospective album that features some of his most memorable creative partnerships, including duets with such artists as Stevie Nicks, Rod Stewart, Michael McDonald, Barry Manilow, and Luther Vandross, plus 3 newly recorded tracks. Koz is known for such hits as You Make Me Smile, his signature song Castle of Dreams, Can't Let You Go, featuring the late Luther Vandross, Together Again, Honey Dipped, All I See Is You, and Faces of a Heart, which was the theme song for General Hospital for more than 10 years. Dave is constantly touring with annual summer and holiday tours in the highly successful Dave Koz and Friends at Sea. His 2 sold-out 2017 Venice and Beyond voyages brought his tally of sold-out cruises to 7. In 2018, he'll venture to Scandinavia and the Baltic on 2 back-to-back cruises. Koz also continues to flex his mass communications muscles as a radio personality. As host of his syndicated Dave Koz radio show, he has been broadcasting coast to coast for more than 22 years. In the spring of 2014, he launched the Dave Koz Lounge, which airs Sundays on SiriusXM satellite radio, and Dave Koz and Friends Radio, a 24-hour-a-day radio channel personally curated by Dave on jazzradio.com. Koz has served as global ambassador for the Starlight Children's Foundation for over 21 years. He founded Koz Wines in 2009 as another avenue to support the foundation. Dave donates all of his proceeds from Koz Wines to Starlight. He has also joined forces with Carrie Hardwick and Lori Cisneros, partners and owners of Spaghettini in Seal Beach, to open Citizen, a new restaurant in Beverly Hills. Please welcome my guest, Dave Koz. Hey, Dave.
Terry, after that introduction, I think we should just say goodbye and call it quits.
Right. Thank you. And don't forget your waitresses. Everybody drive safe. Right.
thank you very much. It's an honor to be on your show. I know we've been trying to do this for quite some time, so I'm glad we're finally making it happen.
Yeah,
and you know that I'm a huge fan of yours and love you as a person and love your musicianship, overall musicianship, and what you've created in this world. So it's a pleasure to be here and talk with you.
Thank you. And the feeling, of course, is very mutual. You know that. I felt it important to list your many achievements to give context to our conversation today. So I've got some questions. And again, if there's anything you want to bring up, feel free. Let's get started. As long as I've known you, and it's been a very long time that we've been friends, you've had a strong support team surrounding you, starting with your family. Where did you learn the importance of surrounding yourself with great people?
That's such a great question to start, because I think it really is about that. It doesn't matter exactly what you do in the world in general, not just in the entertainment business, but anything. It's really important to have that foundation. And I think it primarily started with my parents, who were both in the medical world. My mom was a pharmacist. My dad was a dermatologist, of all things. And all three kids went into the music business. Go figure. None of us went into the medicine. But my parents were always there. They built this foundation, bedrock, for my brother and sister and I to kind of always feel like we could take flight and always be able to have a safe landing. And I think I took that concept into my professional life so that I could, because I know me pretty well, so I know that I'm kind of all over the place. I'm sort of ADD when it comes to life. I'm always kind of looking at different things and left turns and right turns and just constantly being distracted. And so to have that team that really provides that bedrock of foundation so that I can kind of flit about and go over there and try this and try that, but knowing that I could, as far as I jump to one direction or another, that I can always come back and there's that foundation there that's solid as a rock foundation. So my current manager, I've had two managers in my career. My current manager has been with me since 1998. We're talking almost 20 years. And my agent has been my agent my whole career, so that's well over 25 years of working together with him, Jim Gosnell, and my manager, Mark Graham. So they form the nucleus of my core team that always think about the long game. They never think about the short-term advance. They always are thinking about what is the right strategy for the long-term endeavors. And I listen to them. I think that's probably the most important thing.
Right.
is they could, anybody can offer you advice, but you have to just stop for a minute to listen. You don't have to take the advice, but at least to listen, that's an important thing.
Right. So it's not just about surrounding yourself with great people, but paying attention to what they say and what their contribution is to your music, to your career, to your general well-being and happiness.
Absolutely.
All the way around. What was it like growing up in the 60s in your family with your mom and dad and Jeff and your sister Roberta? Was there always music going on?
Say it again?
Was there always music going on, or were you talking about medicine at the dinner table?
No, we were not talking about medicine, that's for sure. I had a nice, healthy diet of everything growing up in my house. I grew up in the Valley, San Fernando Valley in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much a very suburban way. Even though it's in Los Angeles, it was kind of like a sequestered life growing up, especially at that time period. And I was born in 63. But really, I feel like my coming of age happened in the 70s more than the 60s. In the 60s, I was still kind of a kid, a baby, toddler. Mm-hmm. And but there was a music explosion happening in the 70s. My older brother was very into progressive rock and a lot of jazz, and he was really kind of way ahead of his age looking back on his musical choices. And then my sister was kind of a pop music fanatic, whether it was Peter Frampton or Chicago or Earth, Wind & Fire. And my parents were kind of classic singers, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Sammy Davis Jr., Ella Fitzgerald. They loved kind of classic stuff. So we would I would be in my house kind of being exposed to all those different elements. And so there was music wafting from every room, but it was very different music. And that was a great thing for me because I was exposed to a nice variety growing up. And also very simple childhood, pretty much, you know, not without its share of craziness and
right.
Growth spurts and crazy stuff going on in my head. Mm-hmm. But I think for the most part, my parents provided a very calm and cool environment for us to grow up in. And I think the thing, I talked about this with my sister too, the thing that they did more than anything else was to inspire their children to feel like they can do anything. Like mm-hmm. just to have that launching pad, whatever it is that you're interested in, we're going to support you, you know, maybe not drug habits and stuff like that. My mom was
right.
freaked out one day when she thought my brother had smoked a joint and it turned out to be his deodorant. Freaked out. I've never seen her freak out like that before. But in general, that's what they wanted to do for their kids, was to give us all that launching pad. And I think it really worked, because when you have that support of your parents, you can never underestimate that. And so few people have it, too.
I feel
very blessed and fortunate that my parents, I had the parents that I did, because I think that they paved the way, way early on, for the abundance that was to come later in my life.
That's a great choice of words, the abundance, because one of the things that I know about your family, and you and both your siblings, Jeff and Roberta, you are all abundant and not just financially. I mean, you all have had very successful and are having very successful careers, very successful, but you're also happy. You have a strong family, you know, so it really, they hit the mark on all three kids.
Well, that's nice. I just had a dinner a couple nights ago with my brother and sister, just the three of us.
Mm-hmm.
And people talk about the relationships in your life and the most important relationships in your life. If you're lucky enough to have sibling relationships that carry into adulthood, and many people don't, and you can't pick your siblings too, but especially after both my parents passed, my mom about 12 years ago and my dad almost 20 years ago, that sibling relationship becomes kind of the most important thing that you have, because they're the people who you know longest.
Right.
Think about it. They span your whole life, typically.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just had this, there was an issue that we needed to talk about. So we got together, just the three of us. It was over at my house, over some Chinese food. And I left, they left, and that night I just sat down and I was like, you know, not to be all cliche and everything, but I just felt very blessed that these two people are my siblings.
Yes.
That we could have an extremely frank and honest conversation that could be uncomfortable and was a little uncomfortable, but you embrace it and you tackle it, and then you...
And you move through it as a family.
Yeah, and it makes it closer. And,
right, it does.
I just felt so blessed. So they have become my foundation, especially my sister. My older sister is really like the bedrock of my life right now.
Right. Before we get into talking more about music, let's just talk about your mom, Audrey, for a moment. She was a pharmacist by profession, but cookies were her prescription for happiness. Tell me the story behind Audrey's cookies.
Well, a lot of people talk about that my entree into the music business, and some people actually think it has to do with my musicianship and artistry, but they'd be wrong, because my mom made these chocolate chip cookies when she was alive. She never sold them. She just made them for people that she loved. And so we developed this plan early on when I was signed to Capitol Records. My first record came out, and everybody at the Tower, Capitol Records Tower in Hollywood, knew that she made these cookies, and we would send them over every holiday season, and these people fell in love with it. So they came up with this crazy idea to start sending my mom's chocolate chip cookies to radio stations. And they even sent her on a promo tour to record stores.
That's fantastic.
Like Power Records and Licorice Pizza and The Warehouse, if you remember those brands.
I do.
And so they would send her with her cookies. I wasn't even around. And they would send her cookies to radio stations with the with the single. And all of a sudden, things started popping.
Right.
And so it was not really payola. We referred to it at the time as cookieola.
Cookieola, of
but
course.
Hey, those cookies opened the doors. And it was very funny. And but I understand why it worked, was because there was so much. My mom had such a bounty of love to give, and there was a little bit of her love in every one of those cookies, and people would eat them and they just would go. It was almost like it was like a drug in there that made people go, okay, I'll help Dave Koz. Sure. Great.
I'll play that.
And you know, it worked. That,
those stories are legendary about your mom and the beginning of your career. I used to hear the stories too. I felt like I knew your mom from those stories, you know, which was, I always thought was really lovely, you know, because at the end of the day, your musicianship still had to stand, and it did, and it does, you know, so I think it kicked the door open a little wider and maybe a little more quickly with love and sugar, and then people,
it's kind of a touch point, a memory for people, like. And it was funny because it was so unexpected. Like, what is this new artist's mom? He's putting out on to promo for him. And it just was a kind of wholesome, kind of funny thing. And it came about very organically. It was not like this big, huge plan to put her out.
Right. It was very honest and just unfolded in a very natural way. And I think that's what resonated with everybody, you know, because it actually was an extension of your music, you know, too. There's a lot of love in your music, you know, and there's heart, you know. That's one of the things that I've always noticed and actually feel a kindred spirit with you, in that, you know, we understand the importance of celebrating the relationships of the friends that we record with and the artists that we work with and capturing that in some way.
Very nice thing, nice way to put it, and thank you for that.
Yeah. So we're heading into our first break. We've got two more segments. Where can people find you? What's your website?
DaveKoz.com. That's Dave, KOZ.com. And on Facebook and Twitter, it's at Dave Koz Music.
Perfect. So we will be right back after this very short break, so please stick around.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it, because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on Inner Talk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Hi, I'm Tim Dolbear, the host of Sound Experience on Intertalk Radio. Each week, I talk with top professional audio engineers, producers, musicians, and the manufacturers that make the tools that we use in the studio each and every day. From capturing the perfect take to mastering your final release, and the tools and how the pros use them, we are going to dive deep into their process and learn from their experience. I look forward to you joining us each week on Sound Experience with me, your host, Tim Dolbear.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al Di Meola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
Welcome to Making It with Terry Woolman, the show that explores the secrets, successes, and strategies for making it in the music biz. And now, here's your host, Terry Woolman.
Welcome back. I'm here with my guest, Dave Koz, and you're actually listening to a song that we recorded together called Welcome to Paradise. That was fun.
That was a fun day. Sounds great, actually.
Oh, thank you.
So we're on the radio together, and we're on that music together. And the fact, the alto and the guitar sound pretty darn good together.
Yeah, they sure do. Yeah, yeah. Well, again, there's another example of an expression of our friendship. You know, that's what I think comes through in that recording and that song, you know, and I don't know that, you know, it certainly would have sounded great with other musicians, but there's something unique about the two of us because of our friendship. And that's again, one of the things I really love about recording is, creating musical situations. And you are the, you know, you're the king of that. You are the expert of collaborations and you really understand the art and the importance of collaborating.
Well, I do think it's a metaphor for life because we can't really do it alone. We can, I suppose, but it'd be pretty bleak. and I'm talking about living life. You know, your life is an intersection, constantly intersecting with people from your earliest moments of consciousness till you're on your way out.
Right.
So life is one big collaboration. And so you might as well be open to it. And I've been in rooms before where trying to make it happen with another songwriter or something, and it's just not quite there.
Right.
And you go, okay, we this didn't work, but you keep trying it. And I've had so many experiences, Terry, where I've been with other artists and other songwriters, and that you come up with stuff in collaboration that you would never come up with on your own.
Absolutely.
And so it's kind of like a insurance policy to take you out of your comfort zone.
Right.
And all you really need is to have an open heart and an open mind and, you know, arms and ears, I suppose, to collaborate with somebody and allow that energy of the union of two people or more to take you to some new territory. So I kind of live on that. I rely on it.
Right. Yeah. You know, I'd like to read a quote of yours that is in line with what you're talking about right now. The key to success is getting out of the practice room. Practice is important, but to me, it's never really music until you're making it with other people for other people.
Yes, I agree. Whoever said that is a genius.
That would be Dave Koz.
No,
and
but
he's very humble as well.
Now, kids come to me and say, you know, what do you recommend? You know, I'm practicing 4 hours a day, and I'm like, get out of the practice room.
Right.
Please
go play music.
Get out.
Right.
And take what you have, whatever it is, and see what it is in front of people. And you'll know. It's like the great mirror. Mm-hmm. You can't really there's no way to really get any reflection of what you're doing until you're making music with others and making it for other people to enjoy, hopefully.
Right.
And then you get all this information back to help give you pointers on where you need to go. So I think practice is important. I spent probably 4 years of my life where I was just completely in that. My parents made a soundproof room out of our garage for my brother mm-hmm. and I to practice and have our friends over to jam and stuff like that. And there were probably, even in high school, for those 3 years of high school, I joined the golf team. And by the way, completely suck as a golfer.
Oh.
But I knew that the golf team got out of school at 12:20 as opposed to 3:10 when everybody else got out. And of course, ostensibly, you were supposed to go play a round of golf every day.
Right.
And I didn't do that.
That was a strategy. Yeah.
I also knew, this story doesn't shed great light on me, but okay, whatever. It's called doing what you need to do.
Right.
The teacher, who was the coach of the golf team, was kind of a notorious drunk who was kind of had his eye off the ball at all times. So I knew mm-hmm. that what I could do is go to some of the area golf courses and take some of those cards, the scorecards, and I would take the card and sort of rub it into the ground, into the grass to get it a little dirty, and then mm-hmm. I would fill it out and I would crumple it up a little bit, and I would turn in these scorecards to make it look like I actually played rounds of golf. And Coach Kratzel, remember his name, he bought it, you know. But
yeah.
What happened, I never played golf. I maybe played once the whole 3 years, but I would go home at 12:20, I'd grab something to eat, and I would sit in that garage and practice my saxophone for at least 4 hours a day, every
Fantastic.
Single day
right.
for probably 3 to 4 years. So I did put that time in. But once you put the time in, you got to get out of the practice room and really see what happens.
Right.
It's very important.
I agree. So only weeks after graduating from college, you decided to make a go of becoming a pro musician. And within weeks of that decision, as the story goes, you were recruited as a member of Bobby Caldwell's tour. And then you later joined instrumentalist artist Jeff Lorber's band. And then that was followed by a 14-month tour with pop singer Richard Marx. In what ways did those experiences help your personal development as a performer?
Well, I was a mass communications major at UCLA, and I had
What
no
is that,
plans.
By the way?
I have no idea.
Okay.
I've never used it. No, it's very theoretical. UCLA is a very theoretical university, and it's kind of, looking into the, it was exploding back then, but that was the
right.
80s, the mid-80s.
Yes.
Now the world of media is just a completely changed landscape. But I never thought that I would, that I was talented enough, actually, to have a career in music. And I was very much a not a, a gregarious person. I was kind of very shy. I had a lot of things going on in my personal life that I was trying to overcome, and music was a way to get out of my shell. But I was still very much just never saw ever being a musician as for my living. I loved playing music, and I was playing in a wedding band and had a band with my friends, and so that part of it was fun. I was making a living as a musician, mm-hmm. Not having to get another job, but never thinking that I would have it be my career. So my parents said on my graduation day, "What are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I figured if I couldn't try music right now, I would forever regret it." And so
right.
I told them, I made a little deal with them. I said, "I'm going to take 6 months and see if I can get something happening in music. If not, then I will get a job." And I fully planned on getting a job.
Mm-hmm.
But 2 weeks after graduation, this call came in from Bobby Caldwell to audition for his band. And at the time, Bobby was, he was mounting his big comeback, and there was a lot of intrigue about him. And the show, I got the gig, and these shows were packed with other artists and songwriters in the music community, because Bobby's always been kind of the singer.
Yes.
And I remember the first gig was at this place called At My Place in Santa Monica, which I know you know.
Yeah, we all used to play there.
What was that?
We all used to play there. The musicianship there was magnificent.
Yeah, it was an amazing place.
Yeah.
So we did a double header, two shows in one night, and the first show goes, and every song, pretty much every song of Bobby's had the sax solo, the big sax solo. Hmm. So I was playing the solos, and I was very happy, and I thought the thing was going great. The middle, so the end of the first show, we go to the dressing room, and Bobby Caldwell, my new boss, is livid with me. Terry, he's mad as hell at me.
Wow.
And I thought, great, this is my first gig, first and real last. Gig with an artist. I'm going to get fired before the second show.
Right.
And he said, what are you doing, man? I'm like, I was playing the show. He said, I'm moving out of the front of the stage for you to take the sax solo, come up to the front of the stage and own it. You know, I'm moving away, so you should really do it. And I was like, really? That's what you want me to come? Well, you only needed to say that once, Terry, because the second show, I was like all over it.
Right.
And after the second show, he said, see what I mean? So I'll always be grateful to Bobby and to Jeff Lorber, who also did the same thing for me, which was I think they saw something in me that I didn't see, and they nurtured it and they reinforced it. And they showed me very, very clearly that I was kind of, I needed to be on this path, and I was completely on another path. So I'm really grateful to them. If it weren't for those two people, I guarantee I wouldn't be talking to you today.
Yeah. That's fantastic. And thanks for sharing that story, because it's very insightful as well. I want to talk about your cruise. You host the Dave Koz and Friends at Sea cruise, which is a remarkable cruise. And on the 3 years that I joined you on the cruise, I couldn't help but notice this very amazing sense of extended family that you've created, which extends beyond the close-knit community of artists that perform to the fans that come year after year. What would you say makes your cruise so unique?
Well, first of all, thank you for your great contribution to our cruises.
Oh, you're so welcome.
And it really is. Everybody is, it may have my name on it, but every artist, every crew member, every musician, everybody is a huge part of relaying this same message, like having this message throughout, which is, pardon me, you're welcome. You're welcome here. You matter. Everybody matters. And that's the beautiful power of music, is there's only one common bond that all these disparate people, 2,000 people, coming from all over the world, descending on a host city and then getting on a ship for a week, there's only one thing that binds everybody together, and that is their shared love of the music.
Mm-hmm.
But from there, you can go so many different places. And then especially in a fractured world and a divisive world that we live in, that to have the experience where there's like a whole, there's a heart and a center where everybody is moving in the same direction. Not saying anything about everybody's differences. We are celebrating everybody's differences. But in that celebration, we're also recognizing kind of our human core. And this is all done, by the way, very like below the surface. Like on the surface, it's just like everybody's on vacation together. And we're all having a good time. But underneath the surface, and very, you know, just right under that surface, is this feeling of warmth and togetherness, and kind of a little bit of like, this is the way it could be in the world, where everybody is supporting each other as opposed to bringing each other down.
I noticed it the minute.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I noticed that the moment the guest came on to the cruise, the first year that I joined you, it was overwhelmingly clear that these people, a very diverse group of people from all over the world, they had a very strong shared love of music, but there was more. There was another layer of excitement and joy that was there and community.
Yeah, I think it's a reminder. This is a great thing. People get out of their comfort zones. And we travel, our brand is seeing the world together through music. That's right. That's the brand. And so we're taking people I mean, of course, we always have new people every year and people kind of filter in and out, but we've done 10 cruises. We're about to do our 11th year. And I think that there's this core group of people that really want to see the world in this way. And we're right. slowly but surely doing that. And there's this feeling like what you talk about, where there's excitement and warmth, and you've got black people, white people, Asians, every denomination. You've got Jews, I mean, all the different religions. You've got gay people, you've got straight people, you've got Republicans, you've got Democrats. I mean, it's all just a big melting pot. But there is that one thing that unites people. And I think this is a kind of a reminder, like the cruise vacation. And it's not just ours. It's all of these. A cruise vacation is a chance for everybody to have multiple days where you can build on that goodwill. Like it starts on day one and then it builds to day two and then day three. And by the end of the week, there's this palpable feeling amongst people that they're vibrating on such a high level because of the music and because of the friendships that are being made and the places that you're going to go see. I mean, on this one coming up in May, we're starting in Venice, Italy, and cruising to Dubrovnik, Croatia, and a place called Kotor, Montenegro, and Santorini, Greece, the island in Greece, and another city called Ravenna in Italy. So these are beautiful spots on the globe. So you go out and have an amazing day in port, and you come back and you see music and see artists collaborating, and the artists are not just on stage. You're eating with them and hanging with them in the hallways and seeing these spontaneous moments erupt in the middle of a piano bar that you never saw coming. So these are the things that make people keep coming back, and I'm so grateful to it. But it's not just me; it's everybody who comes, the guests, the artists, the crew, the musicians. We're all in it together. We're all contributing to make it an amazing experience.
And that it is. It was not a disappointment in any way. Not that I would expect a disappointment doing anything with you, but I was very proud to be a part of the group of artists that you bring together every year. And it was really fun. Really, really fun. And I saw that everybody else was having fun. I know you sold out this cruise almost immediately and added a second cruise. And I know how hard you work to make that happen. So I know you must be very proud of that and the group of people that you work with to make that happen. We are heading into our next break. I'm here with my friend Dave Koz, and we are going to be talking more about music, some more personal stories, and really what it takes to be an artist. So please stick around. We will be right back.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear, host of Sound Experience here on Intertalk Radio. And Source Connect by Source Element is the essential tool that we use to link between my studio in Austin, Texas, and the WS radio station in San Diego. Now, with Source Connect, not only can we communicate in real time and with HD audio, but it's synced up and is of a high enough quality that I can use it for real-time ADR work, remote recording and overdubbing, and it even allows me to remotely control a DAW. Source Connect by Source Element, affordable, high-quality audio and video connection over the internet for all of your production needs.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
Welcome to Making It with Terry Wolman, the show that explores the secrets, successes, and strategies for making it in the music biz. And now, here's your host, Terry Wolman.
You're listening to Dave Koz, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Beautiful recording. Beautiful.
Yeah, thank you. I haven't heard that one in a long time. Sounds kind of nice. Of course, you got to really try really hard to screw up that song.
So let me ask you a music question. Would you share your point of view about the importance of and how a musician can find their own unique voice as an artist?
Yeah, I think you have to listen to that inside voice, which sometimes, because our minds play tricks with us and there's so much chatter, and it's very easy to be sidetracked by what other people say, sometimes you have to just drown it out. I remember there was one time in my life where, because I really didn't take saxophone lessons. I took improvisation lessons, and I took a year of composing and arranging, but I never really took saxophone lessons because I remember early on in my life taking this lesson with this virtuoso saxophonist, and I sat there, and he immediately started to tell me what kinds of bad habits that I was having, and don't do this, and don't do that, and don't do this, and don't do that, and I tried it for a little while, and I didn't like it. I was like, no. I know I have bad habits, but this is kind of the way I'm making it mine.
Right.
And so I stopped taking lessons and I just sort of listened to my own inside voice of like, okay, well, this seems to be working. And the other thing is listening and playing along with records. I wore out, certain records growing up, like David Sanborn was my biggest hero. Yeah. And I worshipped the ground that he walked on. I listened to his every single album. I memorized his licks. I played along with his music. And then I remember meeting him one time backstage. I kind of got through a friend of a friend of a friend, got backstage at one of his concerts in L.A. And here I was face to face with my idol, my music idol, and I was just a blubbering fool. I was like, oh my God. And I finally was able to blurt out a question, you know, and my question was, you know, I just want to sound exactly like you. I want to play like you. I want to be like you. I want to dress like you. And he just said, stop. You know, in that David Sanborn way, he just said, stop. You know, he's so New York. And he said, look, there's already a me. I'm already here. I'm not going to stop doing what I'm doing. So why don't you just let me be me and you be you? Best advice I've ever gotten from a professional.
Absolutely.
And I reminded him of that story many years later. We became good friends. And actually, we did a tour together last summer, which was the dream come true tour of tours for me.
Yeah, I know.
Getting to be side
yeah.
by side with David Sanborn. And I told the story in the show. And he said, yeah, I'm going to stand by those words because I really feel that. And those words coming from him meant the world to me. So that's when I said, okay, I'm just going to really focus in on how I can play this instrument in a unique way. We all stand on the shoulders of the people who came before us. And
right.
so it's important to respect that, to listen to it, to pay homage, to really do your homework. You have to know where your instrument has been before you can say, I'm going to take it to a new place.
Mm-hmm.
But at a certain point, there's a fork in the road. And you are either an imitator and someone who kind of continues along that path where you're just taking stuff and doing it over, maybe changing a little bit, or you say, I'm just going to go my own way. And that's an important fork in the road. I don't think that there's one way that's better than the other, because both are viable and both are important. But for the artist that really wants to develop their own unique point of view, at that fork, you got to go on your own.
Yeah. So let's get personal. In 2004, you were named one of People Magazine's 50 Hottest Bachelors. Is it true that you didn't...
That was a long time ago. No longer hot.
I would say that many of us disagree on that, but is it true? You might want to run for that again. Is it true that you didn't receive a single date from that article? For real? Nobody reached out to you?
Not one. I was waiting
yeah.
by the phone patiently.
Boy, that's just disillusioning.
I can't even believe that actually happened. I mean,
yeah, it was pretty amazing.
Am I one of the hottest bachelors in the country?
Well, I thought it was great. It made me smile when that year when that came out. And that same year, you also made a decision to publicly come out as a gay man, which turned out to be a move that was embraced by your friends and fans. And I found something that you wrote about that experience that I wanted to share. The beauty of coming out, if you don't mind me sharing it.
Go ahead.
For so many years, I had built up this wall of fear, and it seemed insurmountable. And finally, last April, something inside me decided to try to break it down. I got on the other side, and when I looked back at where this wall had been, I saw that it had been an illusion, a total figment of my imagination. And I realized this wasn't just about my coming out. There was a real life lesson here. When you face your fears head on and get through them, you realize there's so much more you can do in life if you take fear out of the equation. I love that you said that. And I'm really proud of you for the courage that it must have taken for you to get over that fear and not hide who you are or part of who you are.
Well, thank you for bringing that up, Terry, and I really appreciate that. And I stand by those words because that was 100% true at the time and still is. And I think in my case, it was about being gay. And at the time when I was kind of coming up, this was in the early 80s when I turned 18, and so you had the AIDS epidemic and gay men dropping like flies. I mean, really crappy time, a very scary time. And I thank God for music because as a kid, I've had all these feelings inside of me. I had no place to put them, nobody to talk to. It was a very different time back then, 30 plus years ago, than it is now. And thank God it is a better time for young people growing up with in the LGBTQ community, mm-hmm. where we have outlets and we have people on television we can look to and say, yeah, they're out and they're fine. I didn't really have that, and I'm not complaining because it was part of my journey. Mm-hmm. But music became my salvation. I mean, I had all this stuff going on, but at least when I played the saxophone, I had this vehicle I could express myself through, and I got a lot of positive feedback from doing it. So it kind of, not to be over dramatic, but in many ways, music, I think, saved my life. But I kept in the closet for all those years because I was too worried about what would happen. And then there was this time where I was like, I can't do this anymore. I have to be a whole person. Otherwise, what am I doing? And I mm-hmm. made a deal with myself. I said, if coming out derails my career and it's over, well, okay, so it's over, mm-hmm. but at least I'll be a whole person. And so I just faced that fear head on, and I realized, as you mentioned, that there really was nothing to be worried about because nothing happened. The only change that happened was inside of me. And everything else, because I was a whole person, everything else started to become whole again, too. That year saw some of the biggest record sales I've ever had and saw some of the biggest crowds at our shows. And I don't think that there was like a real correlation of like, well, he came out and therefore there are more people, because I think it all emanated from the way I was feeling inside. And so
energetically, things changed for you. Yeah.
Yeah. I was grateful for that, and I think that it doesn't matter what the issue is. We all battle fears, and especially the judgment from our peers and our family and friends, and it keeps us hidden. And when we can get out from the shadows and just let whatever it is live and be, I think that that's where the life begins. So I think my life began at 40 when I came out. My real life started at 40.
Well, I applaud you. And I just think it's fantastic. You know, it's been really, really a privilege to watch you grow into being the complete man and artist that you are, you know, and fearless, you know, and I applaud anybody who is fearless in their life in whatever way that plays out.
Thank you, Terry. That's not a perfect science, I'll tell you that much.
I'm sure.
Every day, we have to do the battle again. But
absolutely.
At least when you do one thing that really kind of pushes that envelope, then you realize, like once I did that, and I came out publicly, and everything was fine, I was like, okay, well, I really can do anything. If I did that, I could do anything. But still, day.
Yeah,
we always have to go back to that well and see how we're going to do.
We have about 5 minutes left in this show, and I have a final question. But before I get to that, I have to ask you about the 20 years that you served as the global ambassador for the Starlight Children's Foundation. Why don't you talk about your relationship with them and what that means to you?
For those of your listeners that don't know, Starlight is an organization that's been around for about 25 years that helps kids that are in the hospital for long periods of time. These are cancer victims, burn victims. And it's not just the kids whose lives are turned upside down, but the parents and the families surrounding these kids. If a kid is in the hospital for months at a time, it's really quite a difficult time for the entire organism of that family. And Starlight comes in through various programs, and they help alleviate some of the fear and some of the disorientation and the just making a kid feel like a kid. So they can have programs where in a hospital, in a children's wing, they'll take one room and completely design it. So you walk in, it's a Starlight room, and you can't tell you're in a hospital. So even if it's just for an hour, the child can go to that room and forget for a minute that he or she is in the hospital. If a child can't get out of bed, they wheel this thing called the Fun Center, which is quite a very high-tech apparatus that will connect that kid to the outside world in various ways and to other kids that are in hospitals. And then if kids can get out of the hospital, they do activity days and fun days whether it's in the park or Disneyland or whatever, and organize it for the entire family to have an outing where a kid can just forget that he's sick, he or she is sick. So I've seen firsthand the work that they do, and I'm completely blown away. They really alleviated a lot of the fear and isolation that comes with this whole thing for a lot of families and a lot of kids. And so, and about as I go about my business, I just like to raise awareness and hopefully raise some money for to keep them doing their great mission.
I can tell how meaningful it is to you, and it's a beautiful organization. So, well chosen. I don't know if you chose them or they chose you. Yeah.
Well, it was actually the the founder is an actress named Emma Sams, and my brother and I had the theme song to General Hospital, and she was on General Hospital, and they threw a big party, and I met her there. And she was telling me about the organization, and I said, kind of, I mean, with all due respect, kind of a Hollywood way, I said, you know, I would love to be involved. And I gave her my number, but I thought I would never hear from her. The next day, she called me.
Beautiful.
And she said, we need you at the hospital. Bring your saxophone. I was like, okay. And then I saw these kids, Terry. I saw these kids who were shells of human beings, you know, just so scared and so, you know, nervous about what their situation was, and as they rightfully should be. And yet there was this spirit that came through, this warrior spirit, this strength and determination that I just was like, oh my God, these kids are my heroes.
Yeah.
And I just got addicted to it. I got addicted to seeing that.
I can see why.
I've learned so much from these kids.
We've got about a minute and a half. So here's my final question to you that I ask all of my guests. At this point of your life, with everything that you know to be true, what would you tell your younger self?
relax. I was a big like bundle of nerves and craziness, and that's who I was growing up, because I was dealing with a lot of stuff and had no real way to do it, and many times I couldn't see the forest through the trees, and so I would freak out and I would get so nervous and get so kind of uptight about stuff. And so I would tell that kid, that 13-year-old, that's the age that I always come back to, I say, buddy, relax. It's all going to be fine. Just enjoy the ride and just know that everything's going to be cool. Yeah, that would have been nice to hear.
Yeah. Oh, nobody told you that.
Right. Nope.
Well, it's good to learn it now.
Yeah, it is.
It's sage advice. It's very sage advice. Anything you would like to share in the last 30 seconds of our show?
From the guy who, one of my mentor friends, who said to me that life is school. Like, this is school. When we come here as souls, human beings, we're here to learn many lessons. And so once you kind of recognize that and say, okay, all of the things that happen, you turn from victim to pupil. And I think that really sheds a different light on life.
Thank you for sharing that. I have to cut you off. We're out of time.
No problem.
It's been a pleasure having you on my show, Dave Koz. Thank you.
Thanks, Terry. I loved it.
You're very welcome.
I love you.
I love you too.
Tune in again next week for another great episode of Making It with Terry Wong.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al Di Meola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time, or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. ready to get your groove on?
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one-song mix offer.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.